A woman was arrested for dead naming and purposefully misgendering a trans woman. Therefore, we live under fascism, says V, the ingenious specimen of YouTube's commentary battalions. V is of the opinion that even if we don't currently live under fascism, certainly the trans advocates are fascistic because they allegedly want to force their pronouns on the rest of us, and compelled speech is fascism. We could rebut this claim just by holding the person making it to their own standards. V thinks that people getting their Twitter accounts suspended, their YouTube demonetized, and their Milo event cancelled is enough to turn them to fascists. Not only that, but V thinks that we should listen to the problems, struggles, and grievances of the people who turn fascistic in order to help them and to be humane to them and eventually maybe to save them from fascism.
It is the Papa Sargon thing to do.
Okay then, V. If you think trans advocates are fascists, then maybe the decades of harassment, abuse, physical attacks, murder, deprivation of rights and opportunities they have faced turn them into fascists. How about that? And like you say, we need to listen to their problems, struggles and grievances in order to help them, and eventually maybe save them from fascism. If you can't respect trans people as much as you respect white nationalists, you are a
piece of shit.
On the other hand, we could simply slam V with the fact that he refuses to call many white nationalists as fascists. He calls people who call white nationalists fascists as fascists, but he finds it perfectly reasonable to call trans advocates fascists.
You piece of shit.
Enough of V's defeated argument for now. Let's talk about the meat of the subject. Pronouns. Them dreaded pronouns.
She, her, he, him, they, them.
The words that terrify the virtually indestructible heroes of machismo, logic, and classical liberalism. Did you know that if you list your pronouns in your Twitter bio,
your opinions are instantly invalid?
The classical liberals told me so. So what's the deal with them pronouns? Someone like V would argue that,
mate, all my senses tell me to call you a completely different pronoun than you demand for me to call you. And if I don't call you your pronoun, then the police arrive and boom boom, they take me to wet dark prison cell and my cats starve to death. Mate, you force your pronouns on me, mate, by the threat of violence, and that is compelled speech and fascism.
So, to recap, the argument is that
preferred pronouns being protected by law carries the threat of violence, which is compelled speech, which is fascism.
The second layer of the argument is that
misgendering trans or non-binary people is allegedly biologically correct and true, so how could we make saying, quote, the truth, end quote, illegal?
Right. Thousands upon thousands of people find this argument so strong, so reasonable, that they rally behind Jordan Peterson, so-called radical feminists, V, and all those in between. Obviously, somebody could try to rebut their arguments by mentioning the findings of current psychology and of the experts on human gender. But a million people who understand those things a lot better than me have already produced those rebuttals. Yet, those who listen to Peterson, V, and everyone in between, on the matter of gender pronouns, do not seem to be shaken from their positions. Well, by the magic of free speech, let's shake them from their positions. And then, the man in the lobster castle will have to sign a peace agreement with them dreaded pronouns. Imagine you're black. It is, in a sense, biologically true to call you black. Race, as far as segregating people into alleged performance categories based on assumptions about biology, is false. But there is the social construct of race, and the term black is still hinged upon a biological feature, so it is factual to call a black person black. Like all people, however, you were given a name and you have your pronouns. But there's this person that keeps calling you black, all the time. They call you black, black, black. It is factual, but it surely isn't your name. Hey black, pass me the papers. Hey black, what are you having on your lunch break? Hey black, why did you take my parking space? Anyhow, calling you black is factual, so you can't really do anything about it. It's also legal to call you black, so what even to do about it? That person keeps calling you black, but also they make blogs about how others should call you black too. And that too is factual and legal. So what to do, right? At some point, you are at work and people are gathered up outside and they chant, black, 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 you are black, totally black, and nothing can change that, black, black, black. And you're like, what the fuck is even wrong with these people? But it's legal and factual and free assembly and all, and you're black, so what can you do? You are black, they call you black, period, facts matter. As time passes, there are TV shows with people saying you should be called not by your name, but black, because you look black and that's factual. Academics rally students to call you black, 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 and many popular videos on YouTube are calling you black, 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 and telling people that they should just call you black, because it is factual. So, at some point, this black, black, you are black thing is getting so popular that now half of the people you meet don't call you by your name, they don't refer to you through your pronouns, they just call you black, 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 this, black, that, all the time. Would you say that experience makes you feel your rights and ability to conduct your daily life as an individual and citizen are adequately protected by the state? No, you fucking wouldn't. So now you have to complain and lobby about it. You want people to respect you, call you by your name, and stop fucking calling you black all the time, although it may be factual. Your public complaints are met with angry opposition. You are called a subversive. You are told you want to divide an otherwise perfectly functional society. Polarization rises, the spirits are inflamed, and the protests are growing. Somebody in the crowd shouts a quick thought, a lynching occurs, and you are the victim. Dehumanization is a slow process, but once it catches on, it stays on for long, and it takes enormous amounts of human suffering before it's gone again. Thankfully, our democracies are old enough to understand dehumanization somewhat, and attempts are being made to mitigate it. But the state is often clumsy, heavy-handed, literalistic, bureaucratic, and inefficient. So, if you want to honor your freedom and keep the state out of issues it's poor at handling, stop being a piece of shit. It's the pro-freedom thing to do. Classical liberals told me that the smallest minority on earth is the individual. Actually, that was Ayn Rand. The classical liberalists told me to obey the individual. The Sarganinos told me that the individual comes before the group. Peterson told me that the individual is the key. Well, they should fucking stick to it then. Because if all of you Muppets and your numerous followers can't handle the minuscule effort required to respect a person's pronouns, as a giant group that you are, the collective effect you have on the life of that one individual is destructive. It's a collective of assholes versus one individual trying to live their life through hardship and problems like everyone else. So, respect the fucking individual, you big brain individualists. And stop calling the pronouns fascism when you hesitate to call today's rising far-right cults as fascists. Think about it. If you are not trans or non-binary, you belong in the vast majority of people. How many times would you have to spend an extra breath on appropriately gendering a person on average? 5 times per week? 2? Now, in contrast, imagine you are trans or non-binary. You belong in a tiny minority of people. If half of everyone you meet and contact doubt your integrity and personhood on a daily basis, how can you lead your daily life? Whenever purposeful misgendering is tolerated on the long term, it ends up feeding a culture where trans and non-binary people have their personhood questioned each and every single day. That is a serious abstraction of their rights and their ability to conduct their lives. As such, it caused legislators to take measures. Not only that, but persistent attacks on the personhood of trans people often end up in violence, abuse, or murder against them. It is sensible and humane to have policy against that. If our common human decency was not failing so hard, then maybe trans people wouldn't be targeted and dehumanized on a scale that requires legislative action. But since we can't show basic decency to other fellow individuals who have not harmed us, the state has to step in to babysit our immature asses. Let's not forget that homophobia, which was a lot more commonplace in the past, shares misgendering as a core ingredient with transphobia. Gay men and lesbian women have been misgendered purposefully as part of the attack on their characters and personhood for ages. Today's particular transphobic misgendering is served under the guise of supposed concerns about biology. But it is fueled by the same hatred and bigotry that fuel homophobia. It is the same hateful attack on someone's personhood, latched on their unorthodox gender and sexuality, and has nothing to do with real scientific concerns. If scientific concerns were the motive of the transphobes, maybe they would be concerned about the findings of psychology concerning people who have their personhood questioned every single day. If the transphobes were such great advocates of science, maybe they wouldn't overlap so much with climate deniers. Gender issues are complex. I don't necessarily understand everything about gender. I don't necessarily agree with everything every trans advocate has ever said. And I am not the most gentle or agreeable person either. I have my share of being rude or an asshole. But still, as a human, I think it's worth spending some effort on not being a piece of shit. At the end of the day, in many languages like Greek or Italian, we have to gender tables, doors, rooms, books, and all sorts of inanimate objects properly, because for some reason, those nouns are gendered. What sort of are you that you can gender inanimate objects properly, yet refuse to do that for a fellow human? It takes effort to start a huge global drama fest about gender pronouns, but it really doesn't take that much effort to respect those dreaded pronouns. It just takes a tiny amount of respect to prevent dehumanization. The non-argument of the cry bullies like V is now destroyed from multiple angles. Well, let's add just one more. The story that V was screeching about was not just about misgendering. Stephanie Hayden was the focus of a story published by the Mail early this year regarding her formal complaint that eventually led to the arrest of Catherine Scottow. It is this Mail article that has been quoted by Donald Trump Jr. and V. Yet, it seems the Mail offered a misleading account of events. V, using an article from the Mail to vilify trans people, is highly ironic, since he resented the treatment Sargon got from the very same newspaper during his UKIP campaign. The Mail failed to report on key aspects of the case. Stephanie Hayden has stated that the police report concerned the unauthorized disclosure of private information about her and that Hertfordshire police made the independent decision to arrest Scottow. According to the Mail, the Crown Prosecution Service said Scottow was charged over, quote, persistent, end quote, messages designed to cause, quote, annoyance, inconvenience, or needless anxiety, end quote, between September 2018 and May 2019. So this story is not just about a couple of tweets containing misgendering. It is about harassment and a personal attack that lasted months and included personal information. On top of that long-lasting harassment, Stephanie Hayden had to deal with massive waves of more harassment as the Mail article circulated, fueling transphobic narratives. Hayden said that following the story's publication on the Mail, she has received numerous abusive messages, quote, many of them carrying threats of violence or even death, end quote. This is the self-sustaining vicious circle of vilification and dehumanization, and no decent human should tolerate it. Was the police too heavy-handed during the arrest? Was the police too late to return the laptop and smartphone of the woman they arrested? Maybe, but those concern police officials and should not be used as a means to attack the personhood of Stephanie Hayden. Besides, YouTubers who are outraged by pronouns like V are usually not against bad police practices. If somebody gets unfairly shot or abused when arrested, people like V say they don't care and chant,
play stupid games, win stupid prizes.
Don't break the law, dummy.
Their interest doesn't concern police brutality or maltreatment of vulnerable suspects. They only care to twist stories in a way that fuels their transphobic narratives. Could legal protections for trans people be abused or misused? They could on occasion, but that is not a good excuse to not protect the rights of people. All sorts of laws and rules are bent and abused daily by some of the people they are meant to protect. Fraud, false accusations and frivolous lawsuits are as old as our very institutions. To single out a few peculiar and misreported cases per year in order to vilify trans people out of the hundreds of thousands that abuse the legal system is simply malicious. Thank you for watching.